Yeah, let me start recording. Okay, I'm going to start today. Talk about the opening principles. Okay, and purposely I had held this back because you have to get your tactics right, you have to get your end game principle right, and then you have to go to opening. In opening, also we are going to look at principles rather than memorizing or knowing the openings. Okay, so that is the way. Otherwise, openings is like a big jungle. Okay, it is like an equatorial forest. If you try to go enter it and trying to know everything, there is, even in your lifetime, you will not be able to know everything in the openings. And it is all variations and small things. So that's why it is important that you know the principles. Okay. So I have listed down these 10 principles, which if you follow till level 3, level 4 also, if you follow these 10 principles, I think in any opening, I think you'll be reasonably well. I mean, you can play any opening as long as you stick to these principles. But these principles, I want everyone to memorize and these 10 things and remember to apply. But before that, I will go to illustrate why these principles matter. Okay. So what we will do is, I will talk about. Okay, people are still joining in. So let us look at this particular position. Okay, this is this position, if you see, both sides have played the opening quite well. Okay, both sides have played the opening quite well. And if you see here, something like this should happen if both of them play well. Okay, both of them have got a stake in the center. E pawn is there. Both of them have got. That's fine. Both of them have got supporting pawns, which are bolstering their presence in the center. Right. Then their knights are well developed. Right. Their bishops are also well developed for white because white is attacking. Black is also reasonably good defense, defensively developed. Both of the kings have castled. One rook each has come on E file. Which means that your development is pretty much complete. The rooks are connected. Queen has come out so that the two rooks are supporting each other. Here also white queen has come out. This is what is like ideal position to start a middle game. Okay, that means you have done your opening play all right. And now you can play strategy, tactics, etc. Whatever there in the middle game. Okay, but how to achieve this is, I think initially there are some principles that if you follow, then you will be able to get this, okay? Almost in any opening. And what I'm going to be talking about is the concept of tempo, okay? Tempo means time, actually, in the, I think, Greek or this one, Latin or whatever. The original meaning of tempo is time, okay? Not the matador tempo or whatever that we, minibus tempo. It is the time. Okay. And time is of essence. As we had seen in the beginning of the game, both your armies are at the back, right? I mean, all the pieces are at the back rank. They are not developed and center is left. It is yet to be occupied and we have heard the importance of center, right? So that is why actually development of all your pieces and controlling the center, controlling the chessboard, controlling the most important squares is very, very important because that is what allows you to further down then play. Okay. So it is extremely crucial to get your army out and occupy the good positions. Okay. Now what for this, there is a technique that we can use to actually measure it and see. Okay. And we will see this in an actual position. What is the chat? Okay, yes. Hi, Uday. Okay. All right, Uday. Yeah, this is your first class, I think. Welcome. Who is the unknown user? I don't know. I can't see an unknown user, but maybe that's fine. I think we'll see. I think right now. I think. Sai Pranav. So,
I see another unknown user.
Okay. So what the concept of tempos. Okay. So tempo is any move that develops your as yet undeveloped pawn or piece, right, is called as a tempo. Means something which is moving for the first time, okay? Like from its original square, it is moving. Then it is called as a tempo. If the same thing you move it again, that is not called as gaining a tempo. It is like, because this is all about opening game, right? Initially, you are trying to see how fast you can develop your entire army, right? So we will see the example of this, but let us just understand the principles, okay? So moving an already developed pawn or piece does not count. Actually, I'll show you this one. This is better, I think. One second, give me, because I had updated this slightly. I don't know why the this one is not okay. Yeah, this, let us use this, my Word document. A tempo is any move that develops your as yet undeveloped pawn or piece, which means it is not first time you are moving a piece, that is called as a tempo. Okay, moving an already developed piece does not count as a tempo. What is the second thing? It is also important to occupy the key center squares. We had seen the key center, e4, d4, e5, d5, right? That is the key center. Occupying the center with a pawn should give, be given extra weightage. Okay, so you should count extra. I will tell you how to count it. Okay. All right. And also the scope for free scope for movement of the queen or the bishops, right? That should also count as extra when they are opened up. Their ability to open up is that's fine. So that is also called as you get a weightage extra. Okay. Similarly, controlling the key center squares, even if you don't occupy it, but if you control the key center square by your pawn, right, pawn is attacking a key center square, that will also act as a you will also get a weightage point for that. Okay, I'm just saying this is just a tool. Okay, it's not that later on you don't use it. Initially, when you are trying to learn the openings principles, that time you use this thing called tool called tempos. Fourth point I'm saying is rooks, when they occupy a open or a semi-open file, or they come on the E or D file, that will also count as an extra. Okay. And finally, what happens when something gets captured? When captured, something gets captured, that piece will vanish from the board, and hence any points that you had assigned to that piece because of it, how it had moved or how it was occupying the center, that will also be going away. That will be subtracting. Okay. Now, with these principles, if you follow, okay, and measure, then you will be able to see the standard openings. Why they are called as standard openings is that you will be able to say that both black and white are very much equal. Okay, because they are trying to fight the battle equally, and hence you will see that they are having equal number of points in this roughly. Okay, we'll see this. Any question with respect to these five principles? We will see them in applied in practice, and you will understand them very well. Okay, if not, then I will go and play a sample game. I will take a reset. Okay, fine. So this is the starting position. Okay. And I'll just illustrate it by a game that was played, say, between an expert and a beginner player. Okay, so we will see how does this. So the beginner player was white, and the expert was black in this game. Okay, we'll just see what happens, and we'll see versus then what. So the beginner player plays d3. Okay, how much points we should give him? We should give him 1 point. Okay. Because one pawn has been developed, plus actually this bishop has also opened up, and this queen has also opened up. So half point for those. So actual development will give you full point, and just opening up or giving scope for other pieces will give you half point. So 1 point because the pawn moved, half point for bishop, half point for queen being opened up. Okay, so total is value is 2. for white. Okay, black responds with e5. Okay, how much points you should give him? One pawn moved, so 1 point. It has occupied a key center square and it is attacking a another key center square, right? This one. So it should be given half plus half, 1 plus the original pawn moved, that is 2 points, plus bishop is opened up. This bishop is opened up along this diagonal, this diagonal, and this queen is opened up along this diagonal. So half, so total value is 3. So after one move each, white has got 2 points. Let us just say in this scheme, black has got 3 points. Okay, that is the reason why it is actually black is slightly ahead. He is more than equalized. Now let us see after that what happens. Knight c3, d5, nf3, nc6. Okay, knight c3, white plays knight c3. It's a good move. So one piece developed and it attacks two central squares, key central squares. So half, 1 plus 1, 2. So white score is 2. First move was 2, now is also 2. So total is 4. Okay. So we can write 2. Okay. This value is 2. After this, black's value is 3. We'll just write it temporarily. After knight c3, white's value is 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Okay. And black's value, black, what does black play? Black play d5. Black plays d5 here. Okay, how many points we should give to this one? How many points we should give?
3.
1 for the pawn. It is occupying a key center and controlling another key center. So 2 points. Then this bishop is allowed to now come forward. So 2.5 plus this queen. Now additionally, it can move along this straight path. So 3 points. You're right. It gets 3 points. So black earlier had 3, now had 3. So what should be the value? It should be 6 now, black. Okay. See, now it is starting to look as black is slightly better than white, and which is the condition actually. Okay. Because black has developed better. Now let us just continue. Knight f3 and knight c6, third move. White plays knight f3. One move for knight, controlling the key central squares 2. So 1 plus 1, 2. And earlier score was 4. So 4 plus 2 is, white is 6. Okay, fine. What does black do? Black plays knight c6. Knight c6. Again, 2 values. Earlier was 6, now is 2. So black is at 8. White is at 6. Black is at 8. Okay, black is at 8. So you see how thing. Now let us look at the counting the tempos. Bishop g5. Again, must be wrong. Bishop must be, how can it be? D3. Oh, shucks. I think I have made the mess of it. Okay, it's not actually, not complete mess, but somewhat mess I made it. D3 was the first move from white. Okay, let us. Delete, promote variation. Okay, forget about that thing. D3, but the values remain same. D3 value is 2 because it remains same. Black played E5, value is 3. We had already counted it, white was 3. Then white played knight c3. Value was 2 plus 2, 4 in terms of tempos. Right? Black played d5. Value was 3 plus 3, 6. So black was at 6. Then white played knight f3. Value was 2 again, plus 2, plus 4 earlier. So value became 6 now total. This move is 2 and previous count is 4. Right? Yeah, I had type this one by mistake. So fine. Black moved now knight c6. Again, we had counted the value of this move as two. One is for developing move, and one half point because it is controlling e5, and half because it is controlling d4. Right. So value of this is again two. So after this, black is having 6 + 2 is 8. 8 values, development value is 8 for black. White development value is 6. Right. Yeah. After that, again, very typical beginner move. You can move the bishop, but see, this move does not really do anything because black can immediately put f6 here and kick back the bishop. So that is what happened here. So I've seen this sometimes being played. I think this move is okay if you have the other side has developed the knight and you can pin it. But just as it is, when this pawn also exists and it can kick away the bishop, it is not a good move. So let us see what happens. This bishop moves here. Okay. So development, we will give it as per our rules, we'll give it one value, but it is not controlling any key squares. Okay. So it is only one value. So let us give it. So earlier it was six. Control A. What happened? Text after move. Okay. So 6 + 1 value is 7. Okay. Black plays f6. It is developing a pawn move and it is controlling a central square also, right? Which is e5. It is also attacking the bishop. So you should give value to that also. So 1 + ½ + ½, 2. So earlier the value was 8. Now the value becomes 10 for black development value. Okay. So now bishop has to move back. So bishop goes back. Where does he go back? He goes back to, I believe in this game, he went back to e3. Yeah, bishop e3. Again, it's not a good move at all. We'll see again. It is losing material, but going back bishop, it is moving the same piece again. It does not get you any values for development. So white remains what it was. White remains at 7. Okay. Now, it is even worse. His pawn comes forward and forks. So now white is losing one piece. So anyway, I think we will not go further because already at this point of time, black was ahead in development. Plus now it is winning material, right? So this opening, you can see how it has been played. So how it should be played and how it should not be played. I think it gives you a reasonable idea. But also it gives you this illustration of the technique of counting the tempos in terms of values, in terms of development. Okay. Any questions? Any questions? Have you got your, what do you call? Let us look at this. So all these four, these three, four principles, if you remember, then you can actually count in a slow game, not in a fast game, but you can, any slow game that you play, you can always just count this that way and decide which will be a good move. It will be a reasonably good choice. You will be able to see it and you can make sure that you are not falling behind the other person, or in fact, you are trying to go ahead if the other person is making some mistakes. You'll be able to apply this tempo principle very, very easily. Anyone has anything, any questions? Avigna, Rishita, Pranav. Just give me feedback that okay, you have got it. Say yes if you have understood it. No questions, okay. Sachi is saying no questions. Good. All right. Avigna, today we are not playing on Chess King. Today we are playing in the practice tournament. Remember, yeah, there is now on coming Saturday is our actually big tournament, which will have prizes also. So I'm just put this practice tournament today. So next Saturday I will send out all the rules by tomorrow. But we will play in two groups. One is a higher group and one is a lower group. And there will be prize in both the groups. There is also points for participation and fully completing the tournament. Okay, it's going to be a Swiss League tournament. So you are on next Saturday when you play. Those who play all the games in the tournament will get points, which I will consider towards the overall level 2 certification. Okay, so don't miss it. Play fully. It is going to be from... it is going to be normal time, which is like 8:30 p.m. Saturday. It is going to be like 8:30 p.m. to 10 p.m. So you can finish your dinner slightly early and then join the tournament. Okay, maybe it will go maybe 5 or 10 minutes beyond 10 p.m. also sometimes. Depends, all games have to be finished. So it is going to be on Live Chess. So that's what I think the practice tournament today was on Live Chess. So that is right, Avigna. I have created two groups. Those who are showing the higher, this one, they are winning all the time. I have slowly taken them to the upper group within that. So there are two divisions within the level 2 class, right? There is a, so there is scope. So you will be able to, so you will get players of your strength to play. So there is no problem like that. And there are prizes in both the groups. Equal rounds. Yes, that is correct, Madhura. It is going to be Swiss League, unlike the arena tournaments. Swiss League means everybody will play exactly same number of games. And everybody has to play. I mean, they cannot just take a break or take a thing. In arena tournaments, you can take a pause in between, you can go. But in this tournament, it will not be like that. Okay, once you start, you will have to play. Otherwise, you will forfeit your game. So, yeah. So, what I will do is, so that is so much about the upcoming tournament. Somebody was saying something?
Uncle, I didn't understand what a tempo is.
Oh, tempo, maybe you did not. See, tempo is any move that develops your undeveloped pawn or piece. Undeveloped means which is there on the starting position. Okay, that is what is meaning of tempo.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and also you get additional points for occupying the key center square or controlling the key center square or giving free scope of movement for queen or bishop. Okay, so that is what I just walked through. We will see that example again in some standard openings. Okay, now let us see some standard openings. Okay, we'll say, and you'll be able to see, apply this principle and see Scotch game. I have talked about Scotch game, right? E4, E5, NF3, NC6, D4, ED4, ND4, NF6, NC3, Bishop C5. I've just given 5 moves, but this is a very popular variation of Scotch game. Now we'll see this, how does it fare with respect to the this one, with respect to the tempos. Okay, we'll see. White plays E4. As per our tempo values, what is the value of this move? 1 plus half plus half, 2. Plus bishop is moved plus queen. I mean, bishop and queen get a movement scope. So value is 3. Black also plays E5. Value is again 3. Right? 1 for the pawn movement. 1 because half because queen can move. Half because bishop can move. Half because pawn is occupying the central square and half because it is controlling an additional central square. So value is 3. Okay, knight F3. Value is 2 because knight is developed and it is controlling 2 central squares. So white's value becomes 3 plus 2 equal to 5. Okay, black plays knight C6. Again, value is 2. So 3 plus 2 is 5. White plays D4. How much value we should give to the move? 1 because it is moving the unmoved pawn. It is controlling central square or attacking and occupying it. So value is 2 plus bishop can move and queen can move along. So again, value is 3. So earlier value was 5 plus now 3. So what is the value of development value of white is 8. Okay. Black exchanges this pawn. Okay. The same pawn moved. So black does not get any value because of that, but it is occupying a key central square So you still get a half value because of that. Okay, but it is not occupying any additional. Earlier also it controlled that central square. Now also it is occupying it. So no value extra for that. But white's pawn has disappeared from the board. Okay, so while black's value remains same, we'll see. What was the black's value earlier? It was 5, right? Now black remains 5, but white's that central pawn has disappeared. That pawn which had given it the value 3, d4 pawn had move had given it value 3, that pawn has disappeared. So now black remains at 5, white also becomes 5 because that pawn has gone. So I'll call it as black's value is 5, white's value is also 5. Now white takes this pawn with the knight. How much value to be given? It is the same knight moving. So no value, no additional squares controlled. So no value. So what is white's count? White's count is also at 5. Okay. Then black plays knight f6. Value is 2. Because it is developing an undeveloped piece and controlling two key central squares, right? So value earlier was 5 and now plus 2, it becomes 7. And white also plays knight knight f6, knight c3. What does value again 2? So earlier it was 7, now it becomes 9. And now black plays bishop to c5. This is the position after 5 moves. Okay, how much value we should give to the bishop? 1 because it has moved and half because it is controlling a key square. Earlier it was 7, now it is 1.5, so 8.5, right? See, it is almost equal, right? Almost equal. So this is how all the standard openings I have given. I'll send the handout, but if you follow all the openings and you do count like this, right, in this handout I am going to send it, you will find, and I have given some standard openings, the first only about 5 moves or so, so that's all you need to know right now. Later on you can learn more, but in all these moves, say Scotch game, Scotch gambit, then Italian game, right, Ivan's gambit, King's Gambit, Ruy Lopez, Two Knights game. See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 basic openings I have just shown here. Scotch Gambit. Yeah, Scotch Gambit starts as a Scotch game, but then white gives away a pawn. Many times we have played this in our tournaments, Avigna. E4, E5, NF3, NC6, D4, ED4, but instead of knight taking D4, like what we did here, instead of that, white develops his bishop and sacrifices the pawn for development. So that is the Scotch Gambit. We have played some games. So you can now, what is the homework for you in all these 7 openings? 1 I have already covered. In the remaining 6 openings, you just try and calculate the values of the tempos. Put it in your notebook and calculate it. Okay. And then you will see, you will realize that more or less in this, it is equal. Okay, that is how the good openings are automatically played, right? So this was one thing that I wanted to cover today about the opening principles. Now, these same principles, I'll take it up a little bit, no problem. In fact, I'll share the screen also. See, once the tempo rule, you have got it, right? After that, you can memorize this simple 10 principles of playing openings. They're very principle. And Avigna, in our apartment only, we had shown this. You guys know this by heart, but others, for they might be seeing it for the first time, right? So yeah, Ivan's Gambit is a very attacking gambit. Very nice opening to play. You are right, Uday. Okay, so then you can memorize this thing. These are all fairly standard principles that you will understand, and you would already be playing if you are following the tempo rules. Okay, So I will send this handout on WhatsApp. So you will have it for your reference. But that is the homework for this week and getting ready for the Saturday. Okay. So Saturday, I want everybody that you should not make basic mistakes in the opening. Okay. So play properly. You apply this. So you have 3 days. So if you really do this homework and apply things, you will definitely play better openings on Saturday. Yes, I will send it on WhatsApp. Yes, that's right, Avigna. Okay, so that is what it was to cover today. Next Saturday, we will not have a lecture because we are having the full time as a tournament. Okay, 1.5 hours, 100 minutes maybe. I think it will be a 4-round Swiss League. Okay, everyone will play 4 games, whichever group that they are part of. But remember to join before 8:30 p.m. By 8:20, 8 p.m., you should have finished your food, have some water, maybe have some water bottle nearby, and you should be ready to play the games. Okay? Don't miss it. Even participation carries points, okay? As I said, participating in the game and fully playing all the 4 games, irrespective of what is the thing, wins or loss, but playing seriously all the games will give you points. Very important.
Sir, what time is it in Pacific time?
What is that? Pacific time?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think you can just check. India time, 8:30 p.m. So whatever, we started at 9 p.m., right? Half an hour before that. So right now it is 9:30 p.m., 9:36 p.m., 1 hour before this. So whatever is your time. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Your voice is breaking. Your voice is breaking. You might have to type.
Okay.
It is really breaking. It is Amodini, right? No, it is Lakshmi. Okay. Fine. Any other question on this one? If not, then we are ready to go back and complete our practice games. Okay, I am hoping that I will be able to also play against some more people. Interesting games. Okay, all right, I am going to stop recording now.